Tuesday's episode, episode 127 of Collider Heroes. I'm John Schnepp. We're still into San Diego Comic-Con. We're just like unloading, unpacking, refreshing, rewinding, and reabsorbing everything that just happened the last week and letting you guys know more about it. Joining me, as always, Amy Dallin.
Hello.
What's going on?
We have so much to talk about.
There's so much San Diego Comic-Con goodness. Special guest sitting in for Mark. For Robert Meyer Burnett is Mark Ellis.
I'm
Mark
Ellis.
Whoa, what an exciting day for me. Now, Amy, I know clearly what's on your shirt and what's represented there. Schnepp, I don't know what is your shirt about. Is that some sort of cinematic film I should be exploring?
Yeah. They had a thing.
What is he, Blade Runner?
Blade Runner. Yeah. It's a Blade
Runs
Runner.
On blades.
Oh.
It's a very special kind of curtain. That, uh-huh. You know, yeah, it's this Blade Runner. It's an amazing thing. Yeah, it's exactly like that. If you watch Twin Peaks, you'd know what I'm talking about. yes, there was the Blade Runner experience. Everybody, I got to live in the world of Blade Runner for about 2 hours. It was one of the greatest things I've ever done at San Diego Comic-Con. I can only thank all the weirdos at Alcon for putting on one of the weirdest and most amazing adventures. If you're a fan of the future, especially Nexus 8s, you missed it because it's over now, but hopefully they go on a traveling sideshow with this thing. It was fantastic. Well, Ellis, one of the reasons you're on this panel today is because you were in Hall H with me. And we're going to get into some of that Marvel flavor. Amy, I wish you're next.
This is me. I'm you, all of you today. I'm just like, tell me the things.
Yes. So let's get right into it. We're going to talk about the Marvel day where we're going to just get right into what I thought was the grand slam. One of the grand slams. There were like, I'd easily say all three of them were grand slams.
This was home
we
run
know how
derby.
Sports work, guys.
Yeah, sports.
Three grand slams.
Yeah, you hit this ice puck thing, and it goes in the air, turns into a weird kind of egg shaped thing, and goes into a hole somewhere.
There's
right,
a lot
Mark?
Of running of blades that are involved in baseball, and this thing was just knocking them out of the park one after the other. I think both DC and Marvel had great days, but Marvel certainly. It's like if you're stacking this thing like it's a comedy show all day in Hall H, then your headliner comes on at 5:15 p.m. And just start slaying it. It was a great experience.
Yeah, let's start off. I mean, I'm not going in any particular order, so I'm just going to start with Thor Ragnarok. Now, check out that image. That's the Hulk bringing down the Fists of Fury on a giant Surtur. Now, they showed a kind of a concept piece of like the 3D rough of this at last year's Hall H. Mm-hmm. And I remember saying, that looked a lot like Surtur. Well, guess what? It's Surtur. And luckily, everyone on the planet Earth got a chance to see the Thor Ragnarok trailer.
Yes.
But what they didn't see is the 5 minutes before that, where they basically kind of give you like Thor's like lockdown on this kind of like really creepy like train ride to Sakaar. And there's this soothing voice saying, welcome, you are going to be visiting Sakaar, one of the seven magnet planets of blah, blah, blah. And then you see a shadow of Jeff Goldblum, like doing this weird, you know, Sakaar is run by the ruler of the Contest of Champions. For all you sweaties who've ever read Contest of Champions, is the ruler of the Contest of Champions, the Grand Master. And then all of a sudden, everything starts to transform around Thor. It looks like weird flesh orbs and teeth, and Thor's like still strapped on. He's like, ah, starts screaming. And then we're in the Grand Master, and he's surrounded. Mark? What else happened?
I love how they throw Thor in like the Six Flags restraints, and even Thor can't get out of it. So you know it's packing some punch if Thor can't break free from this stuff. And here's some sweaty corner nuggets, as you would prefer to say, is that I got to see a sneak peek of this scene a couple months ago when I took a tour of Marvel here in Burbank, California, and they showed it. Taika Waititi was actually there and showed this one little scene that he is actually in. He does a voice and he does motion capture for a rock-like creature. So when Thor meets him, that's the scene that I saw, but it wasn't quite finished yet, and it was finished and ready to show to everybody in Hall H. Leading up to that scene is what Schnepp was talking about, with Thor strapped in and getting this quick bird's eye view of everything that happens on Sakaar, and then he actually gets promoted to be in the throne room with this guy, obviously played by Jeff Goldblum, and it's great to see Tessa Thompson right there next to him, and they have a back and forth because Thor is something that she brought to him to say, I believe he's worthy to take on our champion, which at that point, we don't know who the champion is yet.
Right.
We do. Thor might not. And then he gets thrown into this little weird time warp thing where he's just kind of running around in circles. And it feels a lot like Gladiator almost, where he is one of the any numbers of guys who want to be like Maximus and actually win their freedom back. He gets thrown into the pit, and I think we know what happens next. He sees a friend from work.
Yeah, so Taika's role, the character he's playing, is this kind of like blue thing. It looks like he's made of rocks, but he's like, he looks a lot like the Thing, but he's all blue.
Really funny, too. Yeah, good comedy there.
Taika basically said, like, on the panel, he was like, oh, I'm just imitating a Polynesian bouncer. Mm-hmm. He's like, hey, but they're very polite. They're like these giant guys, but like, hey, man, is everything okay? You know, just kind of, you want to hang out and talk with me? So he was like doing that kind of, so this giant rock-like guy's like, hey, you know, it's like, you know, it'd be cool to hang out with you, you know? It's like, let's just be buddies. You know, he starts walking with him. Thor's running around trying to get out of this thing.
Well, it reminded me of the first time I met you, to be honest. It was like, you see this big hulking figure and he's just made of rocks. And then Schnapps, he's just like the rest of us. He's a nice guy.
Yeah.
With like 3 extra feet.
Yeah, totally. So, I mean, that's pretty much, they showed those little 3 clips, the Thor and the little restraint thing, then the introduction to the Grandmaster, and then Thor in the you know, in this kind of holding pen with Korg. Mm-hmm. And then they should also show him kind of get released, and he says a few more lines before it leads right into the trailer that you guys saw, where basically Thor says to Hulk, he's like, hey, man, it's like, I'm not even working with them anymore. Remember, he had a couple lines about the Avengers where he's like, look, they went all corporate, or he had some kind of line like that, right? Do you remember?
Yeah, I mean, he's talking about how they got really corporate now, and it's almost like what this trailer did is it gave us the evolution from those fun vids that we had with Thor being Chad's roommate in Australia, and then we start to get into the real intensity that Thor Ragnarok is going to bring in this doomsday scenario once we get to meet Hela, Cate Blanchett's character. Leading up to that, though, the interaction between Thor and Hulk was so much fun that I was like, this has such great comedy nuggets, I almost don't need anything else. But once we got into the intense action towards the end, and then as you see with the Hulk jumping into this fire pit and Thor reminding everybody on Earth and anywhere else why he is known as the God of Thunder,
are you the God of again?
Yeah, that's right. God, it was so good.
All right,
it
Amy,
was so good.
Amy, so you, we caught everyone up to all the flavor that we got to see in Hall H, and then they just were like, look, check it out. They released the rest of the trailer with all that delicious Hela goodness. What are your thoughts about that insane trailer? I just watched it again just to get all jacked up before the show. I was like, wow, you know, what are your thoughts?
It's such a, like, it shouldn't work. We had talked many times about like that. I've always been excited for this movie, but I was sort of in the like, I'm not sure how to bring together these elements of like needing crazy epic storytelling because it's Ragnarok, and having like a funny buddy comedy, and having this like cool sort of 80s metal like side of a van like thrash vibe that they have. And the trailer has completely demolished any remaining like questions I had about whether that was a thing you could do, because just in the course of that trailer, like, everything works, everything blends together. There's so much amazing Hela. She seems like you have to make big choices to have that character work. And they're not shying away. Like, she's got all of the dignity and commanding presence and like sinister air that you need for that character to work. And it works perfectly in the same trailer as like goofy back and forth about who won the fight. Me, easily.
Like,
it was so great. I also love someone online earlier was picking out like even more Jack Kirby all over this thing. Like the apartment that they're hanging out in on Sakaar.
Totally.
With like just the weird bubbles in the background where they're just like, what is this? I was just reading earlier, someone was just like, what is this IKEA by way of Jack Kirby place? I want to go there for all my apartment furnishings.
That's right.
I'm so happy. I'm so excited.
Okay, here's something that's actually going to damper your happiness
a
little bit. It's because I'm going to accentuate the trailer with some facts that we got from being in the Hall H panel.
Yes.
And I hate to do this, Amy,
yeah,
but we were there.
Tear the Band-Aid off.
What we got, it really is, it's like, we heard that the Hulk is actually just stayed as the Hulk for a while now.
Right.
He's stayed as the Hulk for so long, it's been a couple years, so now the Hulk is almost speaking like a 2-year-old would. He just exists. He doesn't want to go back to being Banner anymore. He's just walking around in this permanent state of rage and anger. He should be the lead singer of Pantera. He's just always pissed off now, and he's fighting people, and there's some in there, Jeanette, where he's actually getting enjoyment out of this, and when we do get to hear Hulk speak.
Yeah.
I think it really added something to the trailer where we got a little bit of levity, and then we also got that awesome fire pit scene.
And I think the other thing that we want to add about the Hulk and that little knowledge that we have now that he's been the Hulk for 2 years while he's been on Sakaar, if you've read Planet Hulk, which all you sweaty should have read, we know he's probably like hooked up with this female gladiator and he's got a kid. So that's why that's going to put the kibosh on Black Widow and his relationship. Because we heard it's like, oh, there's no relationship with them anymore. And there can't be. It's like, why? Maybe if he has a kid. So
Maury,
do you think they're doing it now? Like, do you think they're?
Oh, yeah. I can almost feel, I feel it in my bones. I feel like, the, you know, the Hulk's like, I like being the Hulk. You know, it's good to be the Hulk. I think yeah, he's like the king. He's the big badass on this planet. And that's, and he's come to be accepted.
And the third person is here, which is very exciting.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's just, we were talking in our Hulk wrap-up episode about like the way that they had, like the presentation of the Mark Ruffalo Hulk in the Avengers films has somehow worked despite not having some of the classic like Hulk traits, such as like, you know, that guy can control when he goes back and forth. Mm. And they have found a way to have their cake and eat it too. They're reintroducing things that we recognize as Hulk mannerisms and problems in the context of this movie. Like, just, they're accidentally doing seven more things with this movie. I don't know how, but.
Yeah, they've really found a way to like blend some of the coolest storylines from a lot of the Marvel graphic novels and just kind of make them work cinematically. You know what else is working cinematically? Black Panther is firing off on all pistons. So they had the entire cast. They had Ryan Coogler there. Everybody was there. Chadwick, every single person was there. And they just kicked it out by right away. Like, everybody kind of like had a few words. Forrest Whitaker's very first appearance at a San Diego Comic Con. It was fantastic. I always said, like, how come, you know, Battlefield Earth didn't bring him out there? It's like, no, Black Panther brought him out there. And it was like, bam. So they're like, you know, everybody said some stuff about how cool it was to be involved in this film and how great it made them feel to have, you know, be making this incredible film set in Wakanda. And then they were like, yo, let's just drop some footage. And then we have this entire scene. Literally, it was like, it reminded me of like Casino Royale in slightly in the future, where they're basically, it's Black Panther and his two female guards played by Lupita and Dina.
Denai from Walking Dead, yeah.
They're both badass bodyguards. And man, do you get to see the most incredible act? It's just like, I was like on the edge of my seat, almost standing up while they played this action scene. So it's Claw, basically, and Martin Freeman, kind of like a big setup. And I feel like this is the opening of the movie. That's my feeling too.
I got the same exact vibe that I think this action that we saw, this little scene takes place early in the movie. And you clearly see right off the bat that Ryan Coogler knows how to do action. We saw hints of it when he did Creed with the boxing sequences that he put together, how impressive they were. It goes next level with this Black Panther footage. And what I loved about this clip is that we get to see Chadwick and Lupita and Denai, and they're all in there together. And while Black Panther is the headliner of the movie and is the front man, if you will, as far as the Guardians of Wakanda, everybody is equally adept at kicking ass, and they get to use some of those powers in this clip once Andy Serkis's Claw comes into the picture. And so we see a lot of neat things in this, but what I got overall is that Wakanda is such a mysterious place, and you get such a vibe of African culture looking at these brief snippets that we got. And while we don't know any of the mysteries that lie within Wakanda, Wakandans know a whole hell of a lot about the rest of the world. And when they need to use that knowledge, when they need to use that power, they are certainly capable of doing that. I cannot wait to see the interaction between Michael B. Jordan and Chadwick Boseman's characters here, because it looks like Michael B. Jordan is not just one of these cookie cutter villains where he actually has a lineage and a history that is asserting himself as somebody who should be of note in Wakanda. And there might be even like a Thor Loki brotherly vibe going on there as far as who is the rightful ruler of this place.
Well, they show Michael B. Jordan basically turn into another Black Panther, kind of like almost like a golden suit, and then they just go at it, go falling down some fire pit. That was incredible. I mean, you saw Claw, basically, he's wearing a prosthetic arm, and it just opens up to reveal his, like, super, like, you know, vibranium shocker wave.
If the Fugitive had that arm, it would be literally, that movie would be 10 minutes, and Dr. Richard Kimball would be no more.
Yeah, people were freaking out. I mean, I got to hats off to Coogler. I mean, the shots, the composition, the way that everything flows, at least in this trailer alone, I can't wait to see this movie. Everything, every frame of it is alive with energy. I mean, all those scenes, just that casino scene with them when they're like arguing back and forth, we've got to do it. And then one of the guards is like, I'm going in, and then guards just start firing. claw blast. So he's just shooting point blank at Martin Freeman, who's like, you're like, he's holding up a suitcase filled with diamonds.
And the look on Amy's face right now is the look of everybody that was in Hall H when we got to see this, including the cast and crew that was on stage, because it was the first time that they had seen all of this put together. And the emotional response that the entire hall, 6,000 of their closest friends, gave them, the standing O that ensued afterwards, yeah. it was a tearful moment in a very positive and happy and progressive way. And I think that once this footage gets out to the rest of the world, you are going to get to see why Schnepp and I are getting this sweaty about it.
You're going to freak out.
You're like getting
out.
Me right now. Like, I'm not even, it was 3 days ago and I wasn't there and it's still killing me. I hope some of y'all are with me.
I mean, I make women cry a lot anyway, so it might be that, but.
No, it's truly powerful footage, and it's really great to see this character come to life, and in such a more expansive way. Like, I love the introduction in Civil War to the Black Panther. It was such a powerful, great way to introduce this great character, and now we're seeing all of the storyline of Wakanda, of what vibranium is, what all these things coming together. It's just fantastic.
The hardest decision, the hardest competition that I am pitting in my head right now from what I saw in Hall H all day Saturday, who is better at landing on top of cars, Aquaman or Black Panther?
Ooh.
That is so neck and neck right now. You know, I don't know who's winning.
I'm going to have to say I'm going to give it to Black Panther, because not only
he's
does
got the claws that like station him in.
He does a backflip and lands on a car, then Claw blows up the car he's on, and he climbs up, runs up a building, does another triple backflip and lands on Claw's car. It was like, that's when they kind of closed out the trailer, where like, or that casino opening, and then it just jumped into all this other footage of whatever this second trailer that they're going to release probably in a month or two. That's what we're talking about, where we actually see all this other incredible action and settings, and they just kind of like give you little snippets of all the different characters. Kind of, you know, I can't even talk anymore. You know what? Let's move on. You're gonna see all this flavor very soon. We want to share some of it with you. Before we get into Infinity Wars, I want to get into like two other quick announcements for Ant-Man and the Wasp. They basically, the whole Marvel panel started basically with Edward Pena and
Michael Pena and Paul Rudd.
And Paul Rudd, thank you. Both of those guys just kind of going through the Marvel's history, kind of giving you a little quick, very comedic look at all the different movies and why Ant-Man is the best and all this kind of stuff going back and forth. And then Michelle Pfeiffer kind of walks in and basically is like, you're like, Michelle Pfeiffer, she's playing Janet Van Dyne. So ultimately she becomes, you know, Janet Pym. But I mean, we're like, that's the best casting news ever. And then basically the real Wasp walks in and they basically walk off. She's like, you know, when I first had my Catwoman outfit, you know, they just didn't have any area for me to pee, and they kind of walk off.
It was such a great way, like comedic way, it very in the vibe of what the first Ant-Man movie was, to go through the entire Marvel Cinematic Universe's history up to this point with Rudd and Pena, then introducing Michelle Pfeiffer. And then that was not the only casting announcement we got. We also got Lawrence Fishburne is going to be in the film. They confirmed that Walton Goggins' character is going to be a villain, and some other neat casting announcements.
Right.
And it all leads up to some early but neat footage and behind the scenes kind of, you know, shots that they're looking at, some computer rendered composites. Just whatever program that Marvel makes these effects on is like so far advanced that even while you're watching them edit a movie together, it still gets you the feels a little bit.
Well, they showed Evangeline Lilly's Wasp outfit, and they showed probably Michelle Pfeiffer, because it felt like it was like from the
70s. Right.
There was this vibe where you're like, you're going to get an Ant-Man and the Wasp mini adventure before you get Ant-Man and the Wasp, the full like modern adventure. But yeah, Evangeline Lilly walks off with Michelle Pfeiffer, and then they launch into all this cool concept art where you basically see Ant-Man turn into Giant Man in the street and grab a car. He's hiding around buildings.
It was
stuff.
Very similar to the Optimus Prime hiding in the first Transformers, but I think it worked comedically in that movie. I know that's a controversial opinion. I think it's going to work in Ant-Man and the Wasp too.
Well, so then let's move on to Captain Marvel. They had a full concept shot of Brie Larson in her Captain Marvel outfit, and then the big news,
the Jamie McKelvey outfit specifically.
Yes, completely. And so the big news is it's set in the 90s. Nick Fury is going to be in it with both eyes, because obviously it's set before he lost one of his eyes. We're going to probably find out how he lost his eye. And the biggest news, Skrulls. I mean,
what?
I freaked out. I literally freaked out when I saw my little friends with the strange chin ridges literally looking like they're supposed to. It's not Chitauri or some other kind of excuse for Skrulls. It's Skrulls. And I'm like, wait a minute, I thought the Fantastic Four and Fox owned these rights. We don't know what's going on. We don't.
Apparently, according to James Gunn on Twitter anyway, like Super Skrull is definitely owned by Fox, right. but I guess they co-own Skrulls as a general concept.
Got it.
Apparently the same deal for the Uatu and the Watchers.
Yeah,
it's... Like, Fox owns Uatu, but you co-own the Watchers? I don't really know how that works.
Yeah, I was reading about the rights issues earlier today, and it's very confusing, but the bottom line is that the Skrulls are like those stovetop stuffing commercials where they get to have it at dinner twice because they go to one house and have stovetop, then they have the other stovetop, and it's all, we win, as if your digestive tract won't win in that scenario, but we do, because
as we know
not
from
only
the comics, do not eat Skrulls.
Yeah. Well, I did a lot of both when I was a kid. But seeing Skrulls and hearing that announcement from Kevin Feige's lips, it was one of the bigger pops that the room gave, because everybody, particularly in that hall, knows exactly what this means when you have the Kree versus the Skrulls and how that could factor into whatever adventure Captain Marvel is
well,
on.
Well, that could also factor into what the fourth Avengers film is going to be, the right. Skrull-Kree War. We don't know what that's going to be or how that's going to factor in, but obviously Captain Marvel is going to be beating the hell out of a lot of Skrulls. Skrulls have a shape-shifting transformational power. What are your thoughts on Ant-Man and the Wasp and Captain Marvel?
So much. First of all, Janet had to be somebody real good. Like, with the amount of, to pay off everything from the first movie, like, it had to be something big, and I'm so happy. Like, I think this is going to be really, really good. So I'm just increasingly excited for that film as time goes on. Captain Marvel set in the 90s? How does this work for the story? Does nobody know she was a hero? Is it a time travel thing? Was she a secret agent? Does she not, like, are we retconning it to be like, in none of these movies has it come up that there was a really famous superhero in the 90s? What does it mean?
Did she buy Cracked Rear View by Hootie and the Blowfish, as everybody else did in the 90s?
I think my guess is Brie Larson's going to be playing an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. And she's on, Ooh. She's going to be in the opening sequence with mm-hmm. Nick Fury. Nick Fury loses his eye. She does something of like a heroic sacrifice and gets absorbed, just like Star-Lord, into some other cosmic world, i.e. either it's by the Kree or by the Skrulls. Maybe she's captured by Skrulls. Maybe she...
Oh, off of Earth.
She's off Earth.
Why isn't she aging? Because I assume she's going to show up in the rest of the Marvel Universe in the present, right?
Yes. My guess is there's something that to do with whatever her suit or whatever the power is that she gets from the Kree. So whatever it is, that's my guess, is all of her adventures take place in outer space. So then that she'll join the Avengers either in Infinity War or towards the end of Infinity War, you know, in the modern time. So
that Infinity War movie looks pretty good too.
Hey, Mark, let's talk about that trailer that we saw. Whoa! Infinity Wars! Man, Marvel has got this drip theory, the saline solution of pain, where they released it to 3,000 people at D23, and they were like, you know what? Let's just let 6,000 more people on the billions of people of planet Earth, let's let 6,000 more people see it. So luckily, I got to see it. I was like, I would have traveled around the world to get the chance to see this film, this trailer. Mark, you got to see it twice. I'm even jealous that he got to see absorb this film twice.
I got to see it twice. My thoughts on the trailer are already on the record, yeah. So I won't bore you guys with the details again, but it's just as good the second time. And the only detriment that you have to playing it in Hall H is that you lose some of it because the crowd is cheering so loud for every hero that comes on the screen.
Right.
Like once Peter Parker's hair goes up, or once you see Scarlet Witch or Iron Man for the first time, you don't hear the next 5 seconds because everybody's going so
a deafening
nuts
roar
for a good reason. But it was so great to see all the heroes unite, and then the appearance, the imposing visage of Thanos throwing again, I have to say, the goddamn moon at people.
Yeah.
Goddamn moon. I can't throw a shot put 20 yards, Schnepp, yeah. But he throws a moon
and
at people.
I gotta say, even though I had read like 35 online descriptions of this trailer, including yours, everybody, so watched videos, I saw clips, I didn't see any of this in action. I didn't see any of it. And when I experience it, it will make your jaw drop. It doesn't matter how many times you end up reading about it. You have, when you visually feel the power, I mean, I got emotionally drawn into it because they're basically... There's 10 years of emotions that we've had running through all of these characters, starting with Iron Man. And the way that I would call it almost like a pre-trailer part, where they kind of go through the history of the Marvel Cinematic Universe by having people talking about all the experiences that they've all had and that they've all shared leading up to this final thing, where you basically see Thor floating, he runs into the Guardians of the Galaxy, don't know what Thor said because everyone was screaming. I mean, literally, that's when the screaming started, people freaking out because Rocket Raccoon is talking to Thor, none of which I know what they said, but literally, then you get to all these incredible cinematic action sequences, like Spider-Man, not only just like seeing his spider sense and just seeing all these characters slowly introduced, and now you know they're all going to be in the same movie together. The reveal of Thanos, where Star-Lord's like, oh my God. And then you just see this black cloud open up, and literally Thanos, without all of his armor, it's like the Thanos from that poster that you see, just kind of shows up super cocky, like, I'm going to take out them. I'm here, like, ready to destroy. You see the Black Order, like, fighting. You see, basically, Thanos take a power punch to Iron Man, goes flying. Then Thanos is literally crushing Thor's head with his glove, like, Thor is screaming. You're like, people are going to get messed up in this movie. Spider-Man in the Iron Spider outfit, jumping around, doing crazy stuff. I mean, it was like, it's sort of like the Hulk Buster. I mean, there's so many shots in this film that happen so quickly that literally when you see it, you're probably going to, when they finally drop this, you're going to watch it like 25 times, just like all of us are. Amy, any questions on Infinity Wars before you see it?
I can't wait. I may have tried to look for all of the, like, this is the side of someone who, right, don't film them. You're not supposed to film them, but I did.
Did you see any little
sideways stuff? I don't know what Spider-Man's sorry for.
It really won't do it justice anyway.
I know.
It's just, if you're the Avengers, hire some good medical professionals because you're going to need it. And if you're about to watch it online, go to Ross Dress for Less, get a new pair of pants because you're going to need that.
Yeah, there was a lot of damaged pants in the Hall H after that. So they were like, here's some posters. So everybody got some posters. Well, that's it for this episode. Come back tomorrow for the comic book pull list on Wednesday. You've been watching Tuesday's episode 127, where we got sweaty for the Hall H experience that just happened a couple days ago. See you tomorrow.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.